Welcome to the University of Liverpool. This is the building where most of our scientific research takes place and where we are going to learn about the polymerase chain reaction.
The polymerase chain reaction is a technique used to make several million copies of a singular piece of DNA. This technique was discovered by Carey Mullis and is now widely regarded as one of the most important and influential techniques in modern biology. We are going to first understand how this technique works, and then we're going to see how it is applied here at the University of Liverpool.
The polymerase chain reaction. To get started, we need our DNA sample and three other main ingredients: DNA polymerase, primers, and nucleotides. Nucleotides are the structural units of DNA, and there are four types: T, A, C, and G. Each nucleotide is made up of a sugar phosphate backbone, and then one of the four nitrogenous bases. Nucleotides are complementary to each other: A with T and C with G. This complementary base pairing is the basis for double-stranded DNA. Within our DNA sample, we have a target sequence of DNA which we are amplifying using PCR. Primers are strands of single-stranded nucleic acid with roughly 20 base pairs which flank the target DNA sequence. Two different primers are required, one for the start of the sequence being amplified and one for the end of the sequence. One end of a DNA polynucleotide is called 3', and the other end is called 5'. But DNA polymerase can only attach to the 3' ends. Once attached to the 3' end of the primer, DNA polymerase can initiate DNA synthesis. This is our final PCR mixture, ready to begin amplification. Firstly, the mixture is heated to 93 degrees Celsius. This breaks the hydrogen bonds between the nucleotides in the DNA sequence. This results in single-stranded DNA. The PCR mixture is then cooled to 55 degrees Celsius. This allows the primes to anneal to the ends of the target DNA sequence. The PCR mixture is then heated to 72 degrees Celsius. This is the optimum temperature for the DNA polymerase to synthesize new DNA with the nucleotides in the PCR mixture. DNA polymerase can begin synthesizing new complementary DNA strands beginning at the primers. This continues along the single-stranded DNA. Following this first cycle of PCR, there are now two copies of the target sequence. This is our new PCR mixture, and the process is repeated. The mixture is heated again, cooled again to allow primers to anneal, and then heated again for DNA polymerase to synthesize complementary strands. After each cycle, the amount of product is doubled. This results in exponential amplification. The process is usually repeated around 35 times, which can result in 68 billion copies.
So now we understand PCR, we can go and speak to one of the researchers at the University of Liverpool to see how he uses the technique on a daily basis to carry out his research.
As we progress through the 21st century, there's a requirement to find fuels and energy sources which will ultimately replace fossil fuels. Previously, first generation biofuels were thought to be the option. However, it turned out that these actually contributed more to the production of greenhouse gases than they actually reduced. There's not a real emphasis on research involving the production of second generation biofuels. The main theme of second generation biofuels is taking the byproduct of food crops, crops which we already grow, and breaking them down to produce ethanol. In order to do this, it's essential to be able to identify novel microorganisms which produce celluloses, the enzymes which degrade these byproducts of the crops which we use for food. As part of my research, we take landfill leachate, place cotton into it, and leave it to incubate for 3 months. The bacteria present in the landfill leachate begin to degrade and break down the cellulose. These organisms do this by producing celluloses. So in our research, by taking this cotton string, our source of cellulose, and extracting DNA from it, we use PCR to identify the bacteria by the amplification of specific genes, and through the identification of these bacteria, we then may be able to exploit them for the production of second generation biofuels and essentially the fuels of the future. So to begin with, this is an extract of DNA which has been extracted from a piece of string, and the string was incubated in landfill leachate, and because the string is pure cellulose, on the surface and where it's broken down, it will only be cellulose degrading organisms present. So when we extract the DNA, everything in this DNA sample will be from cellulose degrading organisms. So what we're going to do is do a universal PCR using universal 16S RNA primers, and we'll use this DNA as a template. So in the PCR reaction, we have DNA, we have a forward and a reverse primer, which are required for the amplification of the 16S RNA gene. And we also have a biomix red reaction mix. And within the reaction mix is everything which is required for the PCR to be carried out efficiently. So this contains buffers, DNTPs, otherwise known as nucleotides. So you've got your A, G, T, and C all in here. And you've also got the polymerase, and the polymerase is required for the extension of the DNA template. So PCR reactions are set up and carried out in PCR tubes, and these are specifically designed so that they can fit into the PCR machine and seal properly. And we set PCR reactions up in either 25 microliter or 50 microliter volumes. So into each tube we'll put DNA template. Forward and reverse primer, and it's essential that you work quickly and try and keep all of the volumes the same that are going into the tubes. So now reverse primer, and finally the PCR reaction mix, which contains all of the components which are required to carry out the PCR. Once the tubes contain all the components required, you can seal the lids and just mix the components all together so that everything is equally distributed. It's then essential that this reaction is placed on ice until you're ready to put it into the PCR machine. So this is the sample that's been made in the lab, and it contains everything which is required for the PCR reaction. We're going to put it into a PCR machine now. PCR machines automatically heat up and cool down samples based on what you've instructed it to do. So it will initially heat the sample to 95 degrees, which will cause the DNA, the double-stranded DNA, to denature. It will then cool down to an optimal temperature, which is different for each primer which is used, normally around 55 degrees, and this temperature will then allow the primer to anneal to the single-stranded DNA template. The machine will then heat back up again, which will allow the polymerase, which is the enzyme included in the mix, to then bind to the primer. And this will then allow the polymerase to move along the single-stranded DNA template annealing gate, hence creating more DNA molecule, DNA template in the sample.
Once the PCR reaction has finished, you remove the tubes from the machine, and we use gel separation equipment known as gel electrophoresis to run the sample on a agarose gel. And this will allow us to find out what organisms are actually present in the sample, in the original DNA sample. Once the samples have been loaded onto the gel in the tank, we can put the lid back on the tank. We then run a current through the tank, which allows the DNA to move through the gel. Once the DNA has been separated on an agarose gel, we then use ultraviolet light so that we can visualise the DNA, the DNA from the different bacteria which are present in the original sample, which we extracted from the cotton. And as you can see on this gel, we've been able to detect five different bacterial species present in the original sample, which we used to carry out the PCR on.
So now we understand PCR, and we've also seen it in action trying to find the fuels of tomorrow. So I hope you'll also agree that PCR is one of the most important techniques in modern biology.